Yeah, so will you give her most cases? Yes. So how many people are there whom you are in touch with, whom you will give such cases?
Two or three.
Why?
We are mixing the scenarios. No problem.
Idea is, whenever there is a restricted, see, why are we, as I said, login concept is extremely abstract. We are trying to give a perception to the user that after this, only you can access, nobody else can access. That is what.
But when it comes to a validation part of it, the blacklist is the simplest and the shortest way to shortlist the characters which are not
on
Google
page. You'll give blacklist.
Let me take an example.
On a Google page, you'll give a blacklist probably, and on a Google type of page, because everybody is allowed everything to write.
Yes.
And on the other side, a backing page, you probably do a whitelist, where you know you want only specific things. So it depends really more on security.
Actually, it's very specific to scenario based. Like for example, if I have a premises, would you? And if there is an emergency, say it's a fire in the premises, what would you like? Would you like to open all open everybody to go out, or would you like anybody to come in? Now it's a scenario based. If you block anybody to go out, everybody would be victim. And in other part, if you stop anybody to come in, you cannot even firemen to come in. It's so all scenario based. In general, if you want to put it,
so
it's
if you are allowing firemen, that is a whitelist. You are saying
I'm not talking about whitelist or I'm not talking about blacklist. I'm talking about what to go for is purely
okay.
Scenario based.
Fine. It is scenario based, but most scenarios demand a whitelist is what I would say. Let's say out of, again I won't give numbers, most would demand a whitelist. Should we go with that? Right? An example of where blacklist is used, as sir mentioned, that say in a public gathering, or let's say airports. You see, when you are passing the immigration, then there has to be a blacklist of defined known bad guys, and that is how they detect. So that is the scenario of blacklist. So it is context based. Most contexts, it is a whitelist. Okay, avoiding dynamic SQL, which is using static queries, we've already discussed. Strong design is connection to the database from the application. They have to be least privileged, only grant certain privilege to certain set of users, etc. Hardening the web server and the database server itself. Okay, this is another. Some organizations go one step ahead and do SQL injection, intrusion detection, where they do not give any information to the attacker based on whether SQL injection is happening or not. They quietly store the IP address, etc., and do an internal inquiry. So that is how it is done.
Can you show the previous slide? This hardening?
Yeah. We are quickly going to cross-site scripting. What I will do is, I will... Invalidation, the sorting of password, though it is not included in this, but I can explain. Would you want to discuss it outside, or would everyone want to know what is sorted hashing and how it is used? How many want to know? Okay, so probably we'll discuss outside, because few of you want. Okay, cross-site scripting. Cross-site scripting is a case of misdirected trust, is what it is. The aim of a cross-site scripting is to either steal some information from the user or perform a malicious activity on the server itself. Okay? Now, in most cases, cross-site scripting would be used to steal session IDs of users so that the sessions can be hijacked and manipulated. In other cases, it can be used to deface websites, to create phishing websites, to steal other information about the user. Now, why does it happen? Because the browser itself is a program which clearly defines two things. One is what it has to display and what it has to execute. Now, essentially, if you consider, browser is nothing but a piece of software running on your system which has certain intelligence. The intelligence is broadly divided into what it can display, what it can execute. Scripts were defined as web developed, and these client-side scripting languages helped in interactive websites which could be used by the client itself. For example, people thought that it would be easier to validate and say that your phone number is not correct rather than send a request to the server and get a response. That is why JavaScript, VBScript, etc. came into vogue. Now, for the browser, it understands that anything starting with the script and ending with the script has to be executed. Anything starting with HTML and ending with HTML has to be displayed, accepting certain other tags. We spoke about DOM, we spoke about single origin policy. Single origin policy demands that browser connecting to domain A can only pick up domain A's cookies from the cookie store. It cannot access domain B's cookies from the client. Similarly, a script or any entity coming from domain A to the browser can access only that domain's cookies. Okay, that is the idea here. Okay, there are three preconditions for a cross-site scripting to work. One is the web application should accept user input. It should not validate the user input, and it should reflect the user input in case of reflective cross-site scripting. Okay. Overall, there are three players: attacker, the web server, and the client. It's not a new phenomenon. It was first identified in the year 2000, and it has been there since then. These are the certain risks which can happen due to cross-site scripting. I will show you a quick demo which will bring the perspective in. Okay, we go back to our Hackers Bank application. Login as user 1. Okay. So there is a functionality which says post message. Now this message goes to the administrator, okay, or probably the relationship manager of the. So let me post a message saying test. I say, hi, how are you? Okay. And I submit this. Now this message can be seen by the admin in the view message category that he has. And if you see, we have this 06 December and it says, hi, how are you? Okay. So there are two things which are happening. User gives input. The input is goes to the admin, goes to the database first. It resides in the database. Admin logs in, tries to see the message, and that is displayed. Now we'll see as a tester how it would be tested. We go to the login, and I give a simple message. And I give a simple script saying alert, hi. S2 and I get a pop-up which has the cookie. Yeah. What is document.cookie? It again, going back to the DOM concept, cookie is a variable of the document object, and hence we are accessing it using document.cookie. Now here we saw that it is working, which means the input is being stored in the database, it is not validated, and it is later reflected back. What can be done? Now this is simple. I know that we can pop up hi, hello, hack, etc. As an attacker, what would I do? Okay. My aim is, since the cookie is being reflected, my aim is to pick up the cookie and send it to my server. Okay, that will make sense, because then I can use that and log in as that. Okay, what do I do? I run a server which listens on a certain port, and my script will execute on in the user's concept, pick up the cookie and send it to the server. We'll see that. So we've got this nifty tool called the netcat, which I will be using here as the server. So I have an NC-L-P443, which means it is asking netcat to listen at port 443. Okay. I have a script with me. I will tell you what it means. This is script, okay? The script creates an image object and tells the browser that this is where the image is. So if you see here, I am saying heavy image is equal to new image, and heavy image dot src is equal to this location, okay, which is my localhost 443 where netcat is running. Okay, now here I am running the client and the netcat on the same system. Typically, this localhost would be changed to the IP address of the target server. Okay. And I say document.cookie. If you see document.cookie, so I will take this and put this as an input as a general user. I've got my netcat running here. I go to view message. I go to club act test 3. Next. Okay. As an admin, I see, okay, Sublime message. Fine. Got executed or not, you see. If you see, the whole request along with the document.cookie was sent to the attacker running his server on 443, and this is the session ID. This is where the actual impact of XSS is. How does this work? Any doubts here? So you were able to understand how cookie was picked up and sent to that port? Yeah? Okay. How does that work? I will show you. Here, in our case, what happens is the attacker has sent a malicious data to the application. Application receives the data and stores it in the database. Alright? The victim, which is in our case the admin, again connects to the server and tries to fetch the data which he is expecting. This data is then retrieved on his browser, and since it's a script, it executes in the background and sends the cookie to the attacker. That is what happens. Okay? I will show you a couple of other impacts of cross-site. If you see in our homepage, when I click on Delhi, I get these results and I see that Delhi is being reflected back here. Your search for branch in city Delhi is something. Okay. Now let me say, I give a script here. Alert I or alert C1 and okay and Now it reflects back. So here our three conditions are met. The application accepts user input, does not validate it, and reflect it back. What can be done using this? It's a public page, right? So for a public page, one of the most glaring concerns is defacement, right? So there are two things I can do in such a case. One is I can deface. Second is I can launch a phishing attack using this website. What I will try to, what I will first show you is a phishing attack using a cross-site scripting attack. The script that I just gave was this. This is my input essentially. Okay? This is nothing but, okay. So here it says script and then it says source, stellone.js, and this. In stellone.js essentially I have an iframe which will come over this page. Okay, let's see what happens. So what has happened here, in our case we just gave the name of the JavaScript since it is on our local host. On the real world case, they will give the IP address of a page which is there on the internet and it will deface the website. That is what it will do. We will see an example of how phishing can be done using this. We go to the login page. I will show you another example. If we are giving an arbitrary username and password, we see that here the credential given for user ID are incorrect, which means again the user name is reflected back. So if I were to give a script here, that that specific username parameter is going on the URL. So what I can do is instead of giving this, I can use the legitimate site name and send an encoded phished URL to a set of thousands of users who are customers of this bank. Since the domain name, here the problem is the cross-site scripting is present in the login page of the site, which means I don't need to create a new domain name. I can use the same domain name even if it is over HTTPS and send these links to all the users. Users will see that the domain name is correct and may click. So the chances of this phishing attack is much more. If you see, here on purpose we have shown you both the frames, or else we can set the frame tag to 100% and it will just cover the entire browser. But here if you see there are two scroll bars, right? One is the original one and second is the one with the fresh phishing frame, and this is the phishing site. So what has happened is due to improper validation on the legitimate login site, we were able to load a JavaScript and load an iframe using that onto the legitimate site, essentially on the browser of the user when he requests for the legitimate site. So this is another example of how cross-site scripting can be used to implement phishing. Yeah, so this is what we did just now. So once we were to give the username password there, the way we have built in our application is, now if suppose I give my username password, even if I give the correct username password, it will just quietly redirect me to the original site. Okay, and save the username password. That is what normally happens in all phishing, real phishing sites. Okay. These are some of the impacts, and now XSS has gone to a very advanced level where we have XSS frameworks. XSS frameworks are nothing but command and control centers where there is a host of people who are infected because of this XSS issue, and there is a command center which will not only know the IP addresses but can also lock the keystrokes, can hijack sessions, etc., do everything. Now there are a number of frameworks which I would request you to go and check out. Beef framework, attack API, XSS proxy, and so on and so forth.